It's Simon T. Gray.
Simon T. Gray.
Everything's working?
So.
So she just called. So it's gonna be about statistics in the call spot. Yes, and this is work in progress, and it's like very much in progress. As in, we were writing, well, I was writing the talkers at like the last 3 minutes. So, Andrei? Okay, so basically what I want to talk about is the stuff I've been playing around with CD, and I'm talking to Nick and Mike about this, maybe we'll eventually write something. Paying people on the roster list. Well, actually, I'm probably worse procrastinator than you, so you just do it just fine.
Unfortunately.
Alright, so anyway, what this is about? Well, this is about data, and I'm really a theoretical physics guy, so I get to like, flash a slower picture of you. And the point being is, we already have a pretty good data set from WMAP, and Planck is giving stuff, and certain people in the audience have seen the data, but they're not sharing for yet, but it will go public in, 2013. And, some of it. Okay, anyway, the maps will at least eventually make its way out, and it would be cool to know what's in there. And not only at the level of the power spectrum, but also at the level of what else is possible in there, characterizing the like possible anomalies. So that's what is about. And this comes about like, you know, in a variety of theoretical models. You typically get non-Gaussian type signatures when you have non-linear rolling things. You have big non-linearity, for example, when you have a couple of models, stuff like that, people who very often parameterize it by adding a small contributions to the usual temperature issue in the sky, which comes from the depth of the potential at the last cut of the surface, depth of the gravitational potential. Normally, if you talk about inflaton creating it, it would be a Gaussian resonant field. But there might be second order effects, and you naturally parameterize them by something like, you know, doing expansion, and my letter pointer is not pointing very well. This is even worse. I don't know. I will just point by. I don't know. It's an unobservable effect, anyways. All reliable baryonic pointer. So, these goals, and basically, very naturally, if you do a point like Lucianity, you end up with things like, you know, Taylor expansion of the function you have. So the first non-Gaussian term you end up with is something like a coefficient times the square of this potential. Now, potential itself is roughly 10 to the minus 5 in dimensionless units, which basically means delta 0 over p is roughly 10 to the minus 5. And I'm like, you know, looking over the factors of 2 here and there. So you would like to go and constrain this guy, and this has been done. Oh yes, I think Jonathan has a better solution for me. I'm not so sure about that. Keep on taping this, right? I know. It kind of looks me like maybe too old for this.
Wait, where do we steal that from?
I don't know. What did you steal?
You're the idiot.
Anyway. I think it's okay if I just point using the, you know, using the pointer. So anyway, the trouble is that it does not necessarily always going to be like that, and if you have more complicated dynamics happening, then you end up with more complicated things. For example, you can imagine this happens during the heating, that your process might be sensitive on the value of the field phi, and you end up with intermittent type contribution to the potential. I'm not going to talk about this today at all, but in certain, you know, heating models, you might end up having no effect for most of the values of the ion curvature mode field, and then it gets converted for certain magical values of the field. So it adds intermittent contribution to the potential, which is a function of another Gaussian random field, which is what was the iteration of the B. And that can get like, you know, intermittent pointy thing over printed on top of the usual CMB picture. Now, since these guys can be uncorrelated, and these guys usually are assumed to be correlated, uncorrelated components are much harder to pick out from the CMB picture itself. And if they're intermittent, smearing them out over the whole sky would be not a good thing. So you would just lose the signal if you try to dilute it to, let's say, do a transform of it. Now, so what I would like to do ideally is I would like to have some sort of non-Gaussianity estimator which can make a map out of non-Gaussianity. Not give me one number, FNL, and one of my, you know, usual complaints about FNL is I don't know where it came from, and I mean there are like point sources on the sky and whatever, so you try to subscribe them, but then when you create transforms, then they get spread out over the whole case, and I have no idea how much contamination you get from, let's say, unexposed point sources or whatnot. So what I would like to have, I would like to have a map of these non-Gaussianities for two purposes. First of all, I want to know where this thing is that contributes the number. Second of all, if there is something amiss with the map, it's usually easy to pick up by eye. So that's basically essentially the story for what I'm going to talk about today is how do I do this in some sort of sensible fashion, and presumably we're also interested in making computationally efficient since I will be dealing with large maps, and if I do the Monte Carlo things for significance estimation, I will be dealing with all of them. Okay, and one of the topics come up is that the first thing you do when you try to do the localized analysis is the bald spot comes up, and this has been around since the early days of WMAP. It came up originally, I think, in the original paper as some sort of excess kurtosis estimators doing not quite what they were supposed to be doing, but didn't get quite clear until basically like a little bit later people did and went out and plotted them up on those roads. So I'm showing that as well. All right, so this you all seen before, and I'm showing it once again. This is internal linear combination map of the W map. Team, that's the data is from 7 year data. And it looks nice and smooth. It's smoothed over on 1 degree scale in fact. And it looks like there's almost no contamination from stuff in it. There's a little bit of things like, you know, punching through here and like, you know, here on the galactic plane. But I would like to know what sort of, you know, things are hiding in that map and potentially extracted from. So what I came up with is the estimators which are data linear, and you can make them local averages of them, and they can extract information which is usually carried by variance, skewness, and kurtosis estimators in normal statistics. So if you do take one of these estimators which estimates the variance, and you apply it to the linear combination of the, like, you know, 5 channels without smoothing, and smooth it to 1 degree, that's what's hiding inside the map. And since I didn't do any smoothing, you can see a lot of interesting things going on. Well, there is a bunch of stuff in galactic plane which is not too surprising. You can also see the jump over in the regions of the masks. That's where you know, various conditions change in the internal linear combination mask. It picks up it very well. And you also have very prominent pattern, which is basically like, you know, this guy and this guy, which have a lower variance estimated in them. And this, as far as I can tell, comes directly from number of iterations. So certain points on the sky got better coverage, but pocket less RMS instrumental noise. And this is done full resolution map. So a lot of the variance in that pixel is coming from an iteration. So one of the things I could try to do, and haven't done it yet, I can try to get the model of the noise and try to subtract it out and see what's hiding inside there. So anyway, those things I'm continuing to look at, and it's also be good if this kind of, like, you know, estimators will pick up some sort of anomaly in the data, and then you, the technicians can write papers about it. And imagine I can get my sky map into the state where I have almost independent pixels. Of course, this guy is correlated, first of all because it's smooth, and second of all because the CMB sloshes around, so there is like this L200 chromium peak into the CMB. But let's say if I divide it by 1 over the root of CL, I make the expected CMB signal 1. So then I essentially decorrelate the signal. So what I'm dealing with, I'm dealing with a bunch of pixels, all drawn from the same distribution, the Gaussian distribution, and presumably just white, so uncorrelated point bugs. Now, how do I characterize this distribution? Well, the complete information about the distribution is carried in the probability density function, either in this point probability density function, like the Gaussian and the Gaussian function, or its cumulative density function, which is the integral of it. Now, it would be nice to compress this data into a sequence of numbers. And compressing the full data is good for the average, so if you get less variance of the numbers than of the whole data set. And one of the, the very first things you learn in statistics is to just introduce the moments of the distribution. So what you would do, you would take a data set of, of pixels x, drawn from the distribution, subtract out the mean, presumably if you know it exactly, you just can subtract out, raise it to some power k, and average over the distribution. Now, what this means is essentially, if you know what the distribution function is, and let's call it f of x, you can just do it, and the way you do it, you can evaluate it for any distribution, you just take x minus mu, raise it to the power k, and integrate over this probability distribution, which is f of x dx. This can be done in sequence, and in fact, this gives you a sort of Taylor-like expansion of the year function. There is an inversion theorem associated with this. If you know all the moments of the distribution, you can write down the series, which will tell you what the year was. Now, the trouble with that series is that it converges really, really slowly, so and it's really messy to write down because it involves inversion of certain polynomial coefficients. Just two objects that you put it in. So, and in this way you can define, usual things as variance, and you can define the ratio of the moments, which are known as skewness, and of course it's skewness is the third moment divided by the variance to the power of 3/2, and for kurtosis, gamma 2 is the fourth moment divided by the variance squared. These three subtracted out of it, and that three is the value this guy has for normal distribution. Now, all of it assumes I know what I'm calculating, that is, I know the PDF exactly. In practice, you don't know the PDF, you just have a bunch of numbers drawn from the PDF. So when you deal with this, you never know the moments exactly, and you don't even know the mean exactly. So what you have to do, you have to construct some sort of estimator to estimate those guys. So in practice, you have a practical problem of building a thing which converges to this value for the distribution and has as little scatter as possible. Okay, so, but there is another way of doing it, and it's very entertaining, and that's what I've been playing around with. Okay, so what's the problem with central moments if I want to do it? First of all, they will involve mean subtraction. It's okay if I do the mean, if I know the mean exactly, but I don't know the mean exactly. So when I subtract it, I will have to estimate it with the data. So how would I estimate the mean? Well, the easiest way to do it is just average the number of points divided by the number of n, and that's the mean. But that's not the true mean, it has a scatter around it. And for me, this introduces two problems. First of all the estimators you write down by translating all these integrals into the sums, or doing the estimate in the most naive way, end up being pierced. It is to say their averages for a finite sample size is not the same as true average of the distribution. And that's, you can deal with this if you're like really, really, really persistent. Accurate prediction. So, you can deal with this if you're really persistent and you can unbias the estimators. Usually increase variance of the estimator when you do this. Now, and the second problem is bigger for me. I want to make a map of it. So what I have, mean, I would like to have it defined in some sort of local fashion, like, you know, for example, on this patch of the sky. Like people doing astronomy, if I see my eight, there's like, you know, variance inside the, you know, like a perfect, you know, disk or other sphere. For me, it would be disk on the sky. And I probably don't want to make it sharp, because it's very slow, high frequency noise, so I would like to have some sort of window function that's making this. Now, what this introduces is the problem right away, right off the bat, is that it's impossible to do in subtraction perfectly. So let's say I take a field, I take a window function applied to it as a convolution, just average it out, and subtract it out. Now, you would think that when I average it up, it's the same, the window function is going to be zero. No, it's not. For a very simple reason, and there is no joke, but well, you can imagine it's because the square of the convolution is not necessary, is the convolution itself, and in fact, the only one which has a square is a delta function. Okay. So let's say I want to subtract out, you know, let's say I estimate the mean as some sort of, you know, convolution is in the function of my data, right? So then I want to subtract this mean, so I construct x minus m. And I would think that this is like, you know, since it's a mean subtracted thing, it will have zero mean when I want to evaluate it. No such luck, because the mean of this guy done the same way would be something like, you know, d minus d and log is x. So it's a convolution window, and that's square of the convolution window, and those two things are just different. Now, this is a very practical problem, because if I want to construct higher moments, they all involve, you know, subtraction of the means and the powers of the means. And I have no idea how to make it work, because the mean and its powers will always mix through. So when I try to average these things out, I will always end up with, like, you know, residual, you know, mean map with the power of 4, so whatever I apply from there, it will get picked up. So this just, you know, I played around for it for like half a year. I did not come up with anything particularly good, which will not be too insanely expensive. And there is a way to try to do it, but it's very, very expensive. So I just want to shut down. Like, is instead of estimating variance like that, by just, you know, subtracting out the mean and squaring it up, you can actually distribute it and do the subtraction between the two points. Let's take x1, like any point draw from the distribution, any value, and x2, another draw, subtract them out, square, and average out, now not all over the whole, like, you know, just the whole draw, but pairs of draws. So that's essentially bootstrapping my simple estimator for the variance. Now, this avoids the mean subtraction problem, but you now have to get all the pairs out. If it's possible to write down the same kind of estimator for the higher momentum, but it will be like, you know, higher polynomials, and you will be doing like, you know, n squared and cube and n to the fourth work, it's just expensive. Okay, so these guys are better, and they avoid the bias problems. It also appears that you might be like, you know, averaging sensibly. Again, you have to think about where, like, from the four points of the sky you want to put the associated mean to, but make it doable, but it's just very, very expensive. Now, so there is better way of doing it, and there is better way of estimating the spreads and like, you know, the skews of the distributions, and the idea is very simple. Instead of trying to go after the shape of the TDF in Taylor series, let's try to go after the shape of the commutative density function. One of the ways of writing down this moment is you just write down this integral among the, like, you know, potential values the variable can take into the values commutative density function can take, which is from 0 to 1, and the quantile function, that is to say the value at this you know, percentile level. It's identical rewrite of this formula, but it brings in a very nice train of thought about these things. Rather than trying to get the quantile function to the power of f, maybe I should be weighting down the data with the powers of the CDF itself. And this has been done in statistics, and has been around for about estimators, which are linear and data, and they appear very naturally when you try to do order statistics. When you order your data, and if you have independent set of data ordering it, you will not get rid of any information you have in the data. So it's sufficient statistics. You can extract CDF very easily by just sorting the data. That gives you estimate of CDF, the values of the pixels, as they go away and increase and increase, and give you an estimate of CDF. This allows you to get the estimator for these linear things very easily. So what you would define is you define a, this lambda moment as a polynomial of rank order statistics, expectations of a variable x, where you take a row of k of them and look for the j's smallest. So this looks complicated. It isn't, because for the second order moment is just nothing else as the average of the, well, the second largest, or the first largest minus the second largest, which is to say the absolute value of the points. So these guys essentially are, and the higher moments are going and have the things like, essentially expansion of the similar things, which is the difference between the absolute values, something like this. Again, ordered in the proper way. So, what does this give you? This gives you an easy way to relate the properties of the distribution without taking powers of your data. So what you would do, you would construct a table of weights for the data. And the table of weights you would do by essentially doing the averaging of the sort of statistics. Now, it turns out it's a very easy thing to do if you know the CDF representation of it. So this horrible expression between here and polynomials is nothing else as just the quantile weighted with the Legendre polynomials on a shifted on the to fit in the interval from 0 to 1. So essentially what you're doing, this lambda case is nothing else as just coefficients in the expansion of the commutative density function when you view it on the side. So it goes from 0 to 1. And you're expanding this function in orthogonal polynomials on this interval. Now, the Legendre polynomials there are simple orthogonal polynomials with a weight of 1, but you can probably do it with other guys and interspherical polynomials in particular, which will give you four pairs of Chebyshev type 1 and 2 and Legendre, those interesting guys. Alright, so what does it do practically? How do I do the estimator problem? Well, very easy. I get my data, I sort it, that gets me a rank function. Then I basically evaluate the Legendre polynomial on the rank of the data, and that can be done once and for all. And then I just have weight masks I can apply to the sky. And if I want to average them, fine, I have, I multiply this weight mask with the data, and I average it out, and I get a local estimate of things in this mask. Okay, so how well does it do? So it actually does quite well for distributions, especially different from Gaussian. So this thing, the cumulants of a normal distribution terminate after the second one, they're all zero. So expansion in things like standard moments does fairly well for normal, but it becomes worse when you go away from normal. And it's actually one of the surprising results is how quickly it becomes very bad when you move even a little bit. This guy is essentially, is suited to deal with uniform distribution very well. So you might wonder how it does for Gaussian or skew distributions. You can play around with this, and here's, since it's easy to hold up and it's cheap, you can just do Monte Carlo for whatever distribution you care to put in, and I would like to test two of them, one with standard Gaussian, one with the probability density function, like that. And the other one is of FNL type. When you skew it by adding a square of a Gaussian random variable, the same one. So that's exactly the FNL type on which many people look for the data of local type. Except I make the coefficient here huge, 1.6. That gives me the skewness of order 1. So CDF of the two distributions look like this. The red one is the Gaussian, the green one is this guy. It's actually shifted and has this inflection point that this guy, the quadratic polynomial, has a minimum. And the minimum happens to be minus 3 times. That's where, what it is, that is the approved zero. All right, PDFs of these distributions look like this. The skew distribution develops a long tail because I add a square of numbers. But the other side of it shifts over, so the mean of it is actually 1/6. And the variance is slightly larger than the variance of the Gaussian distribution. Okay, so I can throw these guys and take a look at, do a bunch of validations and take a look at what my estimators are extracting from the data. And that depends on the number of points I have to play around with. So what one of the ways of plotting it is you can just plot what the distribution of my estimator drawn from n sample points. And I can vary. I can start from very small numbers like 8 to go to a few thousand. And on the sky I have more pixels, the double map sky like similar pixel data set. But if I'm looking at the things inside, let's say, 10 degree patch, that's suddenly a lot less pixels, only about 10,000 independent points. So that's what the usual estimator may be done. And one of the things you see right away, that if you take a look at the most likely or median value of this estimator, for small numbers it's not 1. Well, that's the standard story which you've seen all the time, that's the difference between 1 over n and 1 over n minus 1 in definition of the variance estimator. So I can correct for it very easily for the estimator by multiplying it by square root of, by multiplying it by n over n minus 1. What this will do, it will shift the line up. It will also increase the variance of the estimator. So, what about the linear momentum estimator? Well, it comes out on BS right away and comparable in essentially spread. One of the things you have to care about is this guy is actually square in the data and L is linear in the data. So, to get the spread right, as we just figured out 5 minutes ago, I probably want to put the square of L square in the distribution. Alright. And things go nice and they decrease with the number of points in, and this can be this end of the story, right? Well, not quite. Turns out that if you try to go after skew invariance, the very simple estimators go and become horribly bad. So this is, by the way, to say that the variance you get in this estimator is comparable. This, by the way, is the plot for the skewed one, so you do not get exactly the same distribution, but they're in the ballpark, so they're comparably good. Okay, what about the skewness estimator? So here is the classical skewness estimator, which is the natural one, which you get by just naively applying, replacing integrals everywhere with 1 over n times sum of the pixel values. Now, it's skewed. It's really bad, and the sign of skewness changes with a number of things. So not only you get it here, which is a systematic trend in this guy, you also have details of the distribution shifting around to you when you change the number of pixels. So it's not Gaussian, it's very non-Gaussian distribution of the estimator values. It does not want to converge to Gaussian in any sort of hurry. All of these estimators, by the way, supposed to be asymptotically normal. So if you make humongous set of draws, eventually they should converge to normal distribution, but the convergence rate is super slow, so they are not very, do not look very Gaussian even here, 1,000 points. The L, the linear estimator, which is the ratio of the two L momenta, is unbiased right away. And here, how the distributions look like. Of it, for some examples, as I said, the distribution of the skewness, the natural one, is itself skewed strongly. And this you care about if you want to do significance of estimation of the sort of thing. You want to place 95% bound of probability, you want to know the distribution. So, and if it's not normal, you basically have to Monte Carlo later, and it's insanely expensive. And then you have to worry about rare events, not making the Monte Carlo. Kurtosis is even worse for the natural estimator, and the story just goes on. The higher the moment you get, the more you're sensitive to outliers, the more you're sensitive to the imperfect mean subtraction, and the natural estimators get worse and worse. So L moments do roughly comparably good on all of these things. And here again is the distribution spread. Okay, So what this has to do is what I said. Well, I can now try making maps out of these guys. So they have fairly well determined statistical properties. The distributions of these are pretty much normal. So I know the statistics of them. It's easy to localize on this guy, and it's easy to calculate, so I can make maps of them. And I can take a look at what's in the data. Before I do this, I should make my data white to decorrelate the points. And another way of looking at it, it's a fairly standard procedure you do when you try to do the optimal subtraction of things. Like linear algorithm essentially works like that. So if you have your model of observable, which is a convolution of signal plus potential noise added to it, and you know what the noise is, you can come up with a convolution which tries to take the noise properties into account. Essentially, what we would like to do is just decorrelate the noise and then get it, get it average rate. So, for me, since I'm looking for the features in which are non-Gaussian in the CMP, CMP itself is a noise. So I'm looking for stuff which is intermittent, picky, blobs sticking around in the CMP. So my noise function is the CMP, and that's good because I know its properties very, very well. And signal I don't know, but I presume it's some sort of picky shape which I would like to subtract out, which I would like to find if it's in there. Well, how would I do it? Well, I would come up with some sort of estimator which looks for this sort of things in the data. And the Wiener estimator is in the low signal to noise regime, and we are in the low signal to noise, otherwise these things would be sticking out at us, is basically saying you just have to take your signal estimator by 1 over the noise power, multiplied by the transfer function. And if the signal is primordial, it runs for the same transfer function as the CMP, so it's basically saying I should be multiplying by CLs to the minus 1/2. So that's another roundabout way to get into the story, that if I want to do something with the map, I should buy the data. All right, so. And then I have to average it up. So to average it up, I will have some sort of linear filter trying to look at it in the data. One of the ways to do it is try to go and do the orthogonal polynomial expansions to construct the determinants. And what you want to do is you want to have polynomials not orthogonal between themselves, that will just give you an orthonormal set. But you would like to have polynomials orthogonal to everything but your signal, essentially. So these are the guys which essentially are polynomials which pass the constant through but kill out all the all the powers of polynomials up to other end. So they look like picky shapes. The advantage of doing it like that is that how does my peak look like? Well, it's a peak value, and then there is a parabola sticking out of it because you add zero derivative. If you try to take any sort of like top hat function or something, you will be averaging this parabola. When you average parabola, you bring it down. It appears in that as a constant curve. Now, so that's why you would like to have polynomials, which are orthogonal to the shape of the thing you're averaging this, so that you don't bring the peak down. And it's fine if these guys have side bands because well, the noise is getting brought down by the average square of this polynomial. So I have two parameters on them. One is the number of nodes on the parameter that's the first letter after the SSG. And SSG stands for spherical statistically polynomial. That's, by the way, the top side paper in chemistry. These are used for extracting spectral lines in spectra. And the second number here is just how smoothly I approach at the edge of a disk to zero, that is to say how much high frequency gating attenuation I do that. And I have a bunch of them, the family, so here's like a few representatives compared to the Gaussian. I normalize all of them to the unit gates and unit half bits. And that's how they look like. The Gaussian is black, it has smooth tails. And these guys, they all look like parabolas up on top. But then you have just have a different type of structure. So how does it look like in CL space? If I take a transform of these guys, they actually look like this. that's the pin shape of the exponent to Hilbert convolution of this polynomial. And Gaussian is a Gaussian. Well, except I use truncation Gaussian, so eventually you'll notice that it's simply not Gaussian. And this guy is just approximate a step transition at certain L corresponding to the half bits. Now, they don't do it perfectly. They oscillate, and essentially the parameters they play around with is a trade-off between how steeply they transfer. The higher the number of nodes I have in real space, the more steep I can do the transfer in L space. And the second, the higher the second parameter, the less oscillations I get in, like in the tail parts of L space. So it's just a usual kind of compromise. As you can see here, there are ellipses, which signifies that I haven't written the slide about how we actually do the convolutions in real space. One of the things you have to deal with is you have masks, which makes all of the spherical harmonic analysis essentially painful, because you lose orthogonality of the thing. So one of the things you want to come up is some sort of sensible strategy of dealing with holes. And the most simple thing you can do is, and that's what I'm doing, is the following. So let's say I have, like, you know, my disk in which I'm going to leverage stuff, there's a wave function, okay? Let's call it W. And there might be a hole in the data here. I don't know, it might be a small hole, it might be a huge, like, you know, walking galactic plate hole. So how would I do the data? Well, how would I average the data anyway, if I just had a hole cut out in the mask? Well, I would do the simple thing. I would just sum up all my, you know, window function values. Well, times the mask values, that's my mask, times the values of the pixels x at this point. And of course, when I'm doing this, since I have a hole in the mask, this, like, you know, the sum of the mask pixels don't get added up to 1, so I better divide it to get a true average. And I have to divide by di over mi. And then the thing gets moved around, so it recenters the window function. But masks, like, you know, the excision holes stay on the map. So you look at it and, well, you say, how do I relate this sort of thing? Well, it's a kind of almost a convolution, except it has holes in it. And the very first thing I did is the computer powers chip, so let's just brute force it. It works fine, except it's slow. Now, it turns out, if you look at it and think about it a little bit, well, maybe 10 seconds, that's actually two convolutions that you're doing. One is a convolution, let me put the brackets on it differently. One is a convolution of the window function with the mask data, and the other one is a convolution of the mask with no data applied to it. Essentially, I can account for the holes in the data by just dividing out the convolved, you know, zeroed out map, this hole zeroed out, by the mask themselves. Now, you don't want to trust the brain here, the hole, so if your hole occupies, like, you know, your hole mask, then you probably want to discard it. So what I would do in the maps, I would just put a threshold saying that this guy is better be not too different from one, otherwise it's good. And you can put the control parameter, which will tend to grow all sorts of, like, you know, whenever you have a large hole in the mask, it will discard the difference. So that's how the maps, which I'm going to show you, are done. All right, so what do you do then to your CMD data? As I said, I played around with a number of maps, so I've done this ILC and smooth ILC, grid. Eventually, I want to get the variance out, so to get this, I want to have as many independent pixels as possible. So I'd like to have a full resolution data set, so I did remake the ILC map without any smoothing applied to it. But perhaps it's better if you go and just add the W and V bands of the data according to the gate to minimize the variance of the instrumental noise. So that's what this map shows. It doesn't have perfectly, like, you know, fine done its abstraction, but it's fine because the very first thing you're going to do with this is, well, after dividing it, you're going to mask it. So the first thing I do with this, I widen it. And I know how to widen it because I know my best hit CD spectrum. I can just extract this guy and divide by C out of that spectrum by 1/2. And then when I do this, the map looks like this. So essentially all the long range structure, which is the low L models, get thermalized and it becomes smooth. And what I'm showing here is smooth to 1 degree, so it essentially looks white until you hit 1 degree patch. And then you end up with a bunch of point sources and the galactic craft. And then you mask it.
So the power spectrum was taken for the map itself or for
No, you can do it from the map itself, or you can take it from the best fit. In the map itself, you will have...
Best fit of what?
Best fit of Lambda CPM model.
So in other words, you aren't using the power that's in the galactic plane.
Exactly, so that's exact reason why I wanted to do this like that. I don't want any potential contamination of bad pixels to enter. And that's why, and it's also has additional benefits, actually very smooth function. When the guys who actually extract from data are kind of, you know, jump around for all else.
Well, I think the most important point is you don't want that extra.
Yeah, they don't want the
power to invade the room.
Yes. So it's, if you, in absence of any, good reason of believing otherwise that you can do better with the data, it's safer to use some sort of function which is removed from your pixel data. Because otherwise you cannot get a variety of things, essentially doing non-linear transformations than if you're extracting it from the data. Alright, so after I mask this stuff, and this is the 75% of the sky ignition mask, again, supplied by WMAP, you get rid of all the bad attempters, well, most of them, and these guys and a bunch of points of you don't see. Then you can go and average. So you apply this filter, and the cutout grows because the filter has a certain size. Whenever the disk overlaps in the galactic plane like that, the pixels are unreliable, so I have a cutout. And that curve looks like smooth to basically 6 degrees full disk of mass of the disk, is one of the filters. Now, at this point, you get, of course, everything goes down since you're averaging things out, and things become correlated on the scale. But it looks like essentially random noise kind of pump. And then you can ask yourself, well, is it really a Gaussian random noise, or is it as Gaussian as it looks like? How do you estimate this? Well, since you now have heavily correlated pixels nearby, using all of them it might not be the best thing to do, but one of the good things to do, you can actually, pick statistics of the Gaussian random field, even the correlated ones. And that's was done by ages ago. So what you can do is you can just extract the peak and look at the distribution of the values. So peaks are very easy to extract. You just look at the neighboring pixels of the point, and if you're bigger than any one of them, you're a hot pixel, and if you're smaller than every single one of them, you're also the extremum, except the minimum. And if you're on the side of the mask, you don't call yourself anything because you don't know what you're missing. So you extract these guys, and then you can extract their distribution. And once again, I prefer to deal with two multi-density functions, since it's better defined. And that's how they look like. There is about 530 pips on the sky. And you can ask yourself, does this fit the Gaussian distribution of the pips? Well, it doesn't look like a Gaussian TDF, but it's not supposed to be it because pips are, peak distribution is given by this formula derived by the Bonden and Stadter a while back. And you can ask yourself, is this actually agrees with this? And you can do the minimal likelihood, the maximal likelihood fit of it. And that's how it is. So it overlays right on top of the data, and you can identify just how well you're doing by regulating what's known as Kolmogorov-Smirnov statistics, that is the maximum deviation of CDFs multiplied by the number of independent points. And when you do this and you plot it, it looks like this, that's a residual, and this, pinkish bands is 68% of context levels. The next one is 95 or something like that, and there are another 99 points something. So it is consistent completely with the Gaussian distribution. Except you look at it, well, there is a few points which are kind of a little bit outlined in the distribution that don't affect the commutative function much, but looks like they're a little bit rarer than the usual that you get in the distribution. Okay, so what now? Well, now that I know my distribution, I can evaluate the significance of any one of these points. For example, I can say, well, what's the probability of getting a point as cold as this one? Since I know the CDF, it's right away, I can evaluate it. I have 530 hits at it of this random number from the distribution. I can figure out what the probability is, and it's 1 in 10 of random occurrence. Not particularly rare, in fact, it's happens all the time. Okay, now what then? Then you can go and change the size of the filters and just sweep it and see if there is any sort of peculiarities in different scales in the data. In essence, what you're doing when you're doing a sweep is you're trying to get at the L kind of decomposition, but now doing real space averaging with certain surface. And the sweeper is playing around, and as you're playing around, you should probably see that there is things popping out of it in this region for certain size. So that it recurs once more and keep it watching. And that's infamous cold spot, by the way. It's getting bigger and bigger and bigger and darker. And it gets quite significant. And then it disappears significantly again when you smooth it out. Alright. So how does it look like when significance is plotted from this map? That's what it looks like. So that's the size of the filter kernel in multi-sigma max in degrees. And that's probability of realization, assuming I know what the big distribution statistics is. And this significance itself has an error bound because I extract my distribution parameters from the big distribution. So there is some sort of spread in sigma, and that's mostly important for evaluation of significance when you have like, small number of bits. Anyway, you notice that there is something going on, and like, all of these estimators start to become like, less and less likely about like, 10 to 12 degrees region on the sky. Now you wonder, what's going on? Is this?
Yep. The significance on the left is, or is the values that are closer to isolation.
So effective, this guy, or the left. On the left is. So this guy is just probability of realization of that, like, of that set of x, and this just gives you effective single draw Gaussian signature. Yeah. So it's effective sigma, essentially. It's CDF values corresponding to that one draw.
That's for the good method, or is for the worst case?
So this is significance of the coldest spot. So I'm looking at, I get this vector of hot spots drawn, and I look at the distributions and like, how probable it is to get the coldest one what I've gotten. Okay, and it looks kind of fishy. In fact, well, they start dipping into like, 3 sigma level, and then you get easily get realizations to like, basically, which are unlikely in 1,000 kind of events. Now, this is from quite clean map, but one of the things you should probably do, which I did once I thought about it, is since there are simulated maps around, which goes through the same exactly like pipeline of building up the maps with program reduction, all of this taken into account, I can just go and apply this exactly same procedure and figure out what the mean is doing on these maps. And that's how it looks like on co-edit 42 maps in 7 years old. Four WM, 2B channels, which lambda pairs, and the punchline is there is like nothing remotely like it in the simulated data. So you're picking up something else. And you're picking something else, and it, like, its significance looks like this. So here is like one of these filters which triggers fairly high level. And that's the one which has about 800 arcminutes across. So 800 arcminutes is a little bit more than 12 degrees. At this point, you basically have 100 peaks on the sky. You can still see the distribution. The field doesn't look that good, but when you look at the significance of it, it actually completely consists with the Gaussian. Except there is one guy, so everybody in the distribution is like everybody else. Everybody sits between minus 3 sigma to plus 3 sigma, as you're supposed to in the distribution of 100 draws, and then one guy decides I want to be different and goes and becomes like 4.7 something sigma.
Just like before, that what you showed can possibly look like a real star, like one star.
This one?
No, the one after it.
This one. That's a simulated one.
That's one simulated sky.
So this is simulated sky, this is the real sky.
Right.
So there is no more
than one sky.
One sky or
yeah, one sky. It's one sky. So you guys published one sky map for simulated one, right?
Right.
Which one? This one?
No. The one immediately after.
This one?
Yes. This
one. Yes.
This is a single realization.
Yes, it's a single realization.
Why is nothing below one sigma?
Yeah.
What do you mean nothing below one sigma?
It's real stuff shouldn't behave like that. Should it be in two sigma?
Even three sigma?
Yeah, right.
Well, the correlation is pretty.
Come on, that's effective. You see, thinking why this stuff doesn't jump up and down. Okay. That's one of the things which is obvious, but I forgot to say it. These filters, like, you know, when I scan them, they're so freaking correlated that essentially, like, you know, you're looking at three draws.
That's the point.
Yeah.
Right.
So take one draw, Gaussian random number, what do you expect? You expect one sigma. You just have, like, you know, two draws of it.
We posted more than that, sir.
Well, we had 7 years course of this, but we use all the same sky. We should talk about this, yes. Anyway, I did it post, like, you know, on single channels, you know, like every single map you did post, I did take a look at it. So this is basically nothing like that at all in any of them. Even if you don't go out stuff, if you just, like, you know, you take whatever you post out there and you throw it, it's all like, well, since it goes around in, like, loop it essentially. You know, if I just take one channel, there was a little bit more crap on the low scale of it, but whatever. It's looking for the coldest spot ever on the whole sky.
Yeah, so.
So we can.
We should move on.
We should. One of the things to do is, like, you know, in principle, you would like to test your distributions. You'd like to Monte Carlo with a whole bunch of the skies. Mm-hmm. But the ones I'm talking about here is the ones which are, like, foreground procedure. Like, there's only 70 maps in the park. And these are, like, you know, 7 years each. Over 10 bands of the GA assembly. So I presume they simulate the same sky year after year after year. But if you have, like, you know, 7 different skies in 7 different years, maybe I didn't cut it correctly. But the point is that, like, you know, this really doesn't look any different. I can pull up the old plot. I need their channel of this, like, you know, maps, and they look like that. So, and they look kind of consistent with what you get with random realizations. So, you know, there is, like, you know, one sigma things here and there, and
this can't possibly. This is what
happened. Right. Well, it's not even how. Okay. So you another slide that I didn't put in.
There's nothing more than one sigma.
No. This is the most extreme deviation.
Exactly.
That's the most extreme deviation.
I could agree. There's nothing in the map. Right.
No, there's not one sigma in the map, man. That's not one sigma, that's effective one sigma. So the probability of which is consistent is basically, like, of course, it's like it jumps around and has, like, you know, -3, but you have, like, you know, insane number of peaks. So what here is the probability to have the peak as cold as it is, given you draw, like, you know, 1,000 peaks or whatever.
But if you're giving this value at every at this point.
So, are you saying that the peak should be, like, spreading out between -3 or +3?
I think it's a misinterpretation of what the plot is for.
I don't think it's, depends by whom. Mm.
No, you are misinterpreting.
No, I know what I'm quoting. I'm quoting the probability to get that cold spot. Like, you know, out of, like, you know, how many peaks I had on the sky. How many peaks on the sky I had is a function of this guy, and I have humongous amount of peaks, so even if you get, like, you know, 5 sigma points on the sky, they're well fine. I have, like, you know, lots of throws at it, so the effective probability of reflection is very high. I think that's what you were saying, right? No?
Yes, I can hear you, but.
We should move on. It's perfectly clear, man.
I agree.
I plotted it, it's perfectly clear.
I totally agree.
Okay. But anyway. As I said, this, like, you know, when you sweep, this is highly correlated because you're not changing your filters at all. And, like, unless you go and scale them by factor of 2 or 3, they look very similar. So they pick up the same things. By the way, one of the things I also forgot to mention that all of these, you know, all of these triggers on one point on the sky. So it's not just, you know, there is stuff, but it's just all of it is scanning and directly attributable to that place. Like, weather card. Place, it might shift around a little bit, but it's exact same place. So anyway, let's get to more fun stuff. And actually, is you if you try to get the smoothing out, looks like you can get much higher excursions in the map. And one of the reasons I'm not working with the final number, that it looks like, you know, my Pomodoro deviation test starts looking on Gaussian for distributions X. That's probably because Kolmogorov-Smirnov test assumes independent numbers. So it's probably, and when you don't have smoothing, high smoothing applied to the peaks, you know, they cluster around, so they're not independent. So you're probably overestimating the number of independent points in the distribution, making the fit appear worse than it is. So anyway, with one of these filters, modulo these things, you get, like, you know, basically six sigma kind of hotspots sticking out. And that's how it looks like on the sky. You know, this is this guy at minus 1.9, and for, you know, the highest hot spot here is like a 1.27 or something like that. So it's very, very asymmetric in distribution, and it's actually literally sticking out here. So, looks like there is something in the data, but I wanted, at least in the mean channel, but I also wanted to take a look at the local estimators of other things. So can I see stuff when I go look after variance and skewness and covariance estimators? Here's the brand new maps, so let me remind you, well, how it looks like when I smooth it at arbitrary degree, let's say 6 degrees across, without tuning myself to, like, see the swap spot. So, you know, it's just, you know, generic picture of how it looks like. At 6 degrees across, smoothing the mean still looks like this. You can kind of start making the swap spot, but it's not very significant. So L2 estimator, which is, let me show you the skewness first. It looks very much like it's correlated with the mean estimator. It's picking up the same places. And the cold spot, there is also, like, no cold spot in the skewness estimator. Now, what's curious about it is that the variance, L2 estimator, picks up the observation, the number of observation pattern, like, you know, very, very clearly. And one of the cool things that could be done and that I would like to do, and I would probably do it, is you can go after the, you know, there are a variety of claims on the table that variance of the distribution in the north sky is not the same as in the south part of the sky. Now, this basically deals straight on with the fact that the number of observations masked are not quite right. Particularly, there is a hole in the mask right near where the good observing place on the South Pole was. So I'm not quite sure how much it is leaking into the estimates they use. So I want to go and, you know, figure out for myself what's going on with sort of things. What's also interesting, it looks like the same kind of pattern gets repeated in the worst case in the Cortez estimators. This is supposedly evaluates the difference between 4 points drawn from the distribution. Now, so this should be independent from the variance of the map of the Gaussian locally. There is something else that's going on and I don't understand it. Either the estimators are not quite orthogonal because I'm averaging them and things slip through, or maybe there is something with the data I don't understand, or maybe I just don't understand what I'm doing in general. Alright. So this is a work in progress, as I said. So I can now make maps of these estimators and take a look at how of them. And one of the immediate things that should be done is that take a look at the spread in the skewness. That basically puts all the local skewness estimators between, like, you know, something like 20% one way or the other way. Assuming it's normally distributed, assuming it scales with the number of independent pixels I throw at it, I can increase the size of the, like, you know, averaging region of the whole sky. And then suddenly I can have a lot more pixels and it will go down. And then I can put a constraint of FNL by just looking at the distributions of pixels themselves. Alternatively, I can go after ILMs, which are random themselves. If I raise them and this one over CL, they will be, again, independent and identically distributed. So I can just throw this estimator, which is linear, and they can see what it gives for the FNL value. One of the things that's good about it, the distributions of the estimator itself are very much better behaves than the usual product of three ALMs. And people, like, you know, trying to fight it, but it's not easy to you get specific Gaussian underlying distribution, of course, you have a symmetric distribution, simply because of the symmetry, but if you have even any sort of skew is present, it skews the estimator. And that seems like a pathology, but it's not interview. So anyway, so that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to look at the FNLs and I can see if I can place the root bounds there. At this point, well, this is like the work in progress, so I'll stop here. One of the things which should be tested very well is, well, there is stuff in the data, but I would like to know if it's primordial or just something in the foreground or something in the instrumentation foreground. It's completely unclear what to do, and one of the things to do is to take a look at the frequency dependence and derivation of the signal. Okay, oh, by the way, I forgot to mention maybe a few things. So this is how the variance heap looks like. And this shows you, again, the pattern of observations isn't there on all the scales. I can smooth it out, and it will be, you know, better looking, or I can keep it very small scales, and it's still there. So it really sits in the, like, you know, smallest scale variations of the pixels themselves. And another thing which you can do is I can take a look, since my estimator of skew looks like very much like a Gaussian random field again, I can see if there are sticks, like things sticking out of the field. And very curious things happen. If I do this exactly the same trick, if I go and plot the significance versus filter size applied to this by doing extraction of the Gaussian distribution, that's how it looks like for the mean. That's what it does for the third statistics distribution of it. So it's still picking up, like, you know, the bulk score of 10 to the 12 degrees across at lower significance, but it does. But this looks like there is a lot of, like, those smaller scale things going on in the map, which I don't have, like, any idea of what's happening there. Now, but it's picking up other stuff. So, I have new statistics, it will pick up new things I've seen before, and have fun figuring out what they are. So I'll stop here, and that's what I've been doing for the past little while, and eventually maybe something will come out of it.
Which is
think it's just a...
Yeah, but why is that the issue? Because it's been through white?
No, no, it's because I just take in the data, you know, in full pixel resolution. And certain pixels have more of the variance because there's instrumental noise in it. And this measures everything, CND variance plus actual instrumental variance.
It, yeah, so...
So I just throw them up.
But your pre-whitening was with the signal, and it didn't have the noise in it.
Right, exactly. So I pre-whitened the signal.
If you had done it with signal plus noise, it would have been pretty flat.
That's probably a good thing.
No, that's a question.
No, that's probably a good thing to do. Is, if I know the model of what my noise is, I should be accounting for it. And if I take it out, I should be able to get just, you know.
So you sort of know it because you can estimate from the data.
Exactly. And also know because it's like, you know, it tells me that then, like, you know, assumed instrumental noise is this number times, like, you know, square root number of observations.
Okay, so now I understand.
Okay. So that's what it is, and the next step, obvious next step, is try to get rid of this, like, you know, instrumental noise variance and go into the fundamental one in the CV itself. I just did not do it yet. And that would be cool. But it's interesting to see that this is actually, like, you know, this is picked up from the map itself. It has nothing, like, no knowledge whatsoever about the number of observations. It's just like, you know, whatever the noisy map I have, I just throw it in and it appears magic. So at least it's working as an estimator.
And so the other intriguing question may be raised, which may be our WMAP aficionados to grasp, which is that the infamous north-south asymmetry, which I guess has some aspect of the spot in it, but you're saying that the nature of the masks being different might have caused some of this? Is that?
I don't know. What it looks to me, look at this, there is, like, you know, the two places of the lowest instrumental variance, here and here. I presume this is, like, you know, our ecliptic poles, like solar system ecliptic poles. That's where it stares for a long time. And one of them happens to coincide with, like, you know, cut out on the mask. So you're cutting out some place where you have low variance on the south, and somehow you may end up magically this bigger variance in the southern hemisphere. So are those two things correlated? I have no idea. But
well, the question is, was that addressed well in the papers that are claiming the symmetry? I mean, I didn't look at
it. I don't even know if it was addressed, let alone with, addressed well. Some of the people at least think about this. So,
well, I'm sure that WMAP people thought about this.
So one of the things is...
What's the answer?
What is it?
What's that?
Exactly. That's, you know the fucking line, Mike.
What? It's less than it's 3 seconds.
Which is what?
That's the party line.
Oh, okay.
It's, that's a very space. I'm sorry, it's a very
space. Like the first thing right there. The way you know the bell. It's that thing.
And by the way, that's one of the things you can do for fun, and I've shown this before giving it. So I'll flash it once again. You can just take raw maps. You can do nothing to them, not write them, not do anything. And that's what the second L2 estimator picks up. That's for ILC map. I just throw, like, you know, I make the ILC combination of it without any smoothing, and I just throw it in the estimator and smooth it out to 1 degree. This is the mean, which is basically from WMAP, right? And that's what L2 estimator picks up. So it picks up, like, you know, the region divisions and a whole bunch of stuff and galactic plane, and at this point, since points are correlated, it also does funny things to the extreme values, to the cold spots here, like, you know, and here, and get rectified and become cold spots. That's because there's correlations in the actual, like, you know, data, and this thing is supposedly, like, you know, this estimator thinks the samples aren't correlated, so it tries to rectify this. So that's probably why you want to divide the data before throwing it. Will work much better. But there is stuff. And finally.
Just a question about that. You say something 3 sigma, but you've tuned it to get the maximum significance. That's not quite the same as saying something 3 sigma before you.
Okay, so that's a very valid point. And I actually. Okay, well, let me, since. Let me show you something. I did not put it in the talk, but it exists. And essentially, these things are really highly correlated. So when I'm sweeping the size of this, you know, spots, I'm essentially only doing like three random draws. One of the ways to quantify it is I can construct the correlation of the peaks, like, you know, of the filters with themselves. And let me show you the correlation matrix. That's done. And then you can decompose into the principal components and say how like eigenvalues distributed and do all that sort of, like, you know, wonderful statistic stuff. And where did I stop it? Yes, in the critical work appropriately.
Actually, maybe we should let people go.
Yeah, maybe we should let people go. Especially since I did delete the PDFs and I just got the kids.
You're going to have to show us a matrix.
I can show you the